Welcome to this technology session with Maristella. But before we start, Maristella's talk, we have a couple of announcements to make. Mainly, we are awarding the prizes for the best papers in EJ published during 2017. And I'm here first to award the Austin Robinson Prize. The Austin Robinson Prize is awarded to the best paper published in the EJ by an author submitting within 5 years of being awarded the PhD. Before I announce the winner, maybe just a word about Austin Robinson. So they may be best known for his wife, Joan Robinson. But he also was an editor of the EJ, first as an assistant to Keynes, and then jointly with Roy Herod. And in his academic career, he spent his academic career at Cambridge, working mostly on competition, monopoly, and models of the market. But he was also heavily engaged in policy and worked in the during the World War II in the Ministry of Production. I guess that's going to come back to life now after Brexit. surprised to me, there is actually a little bit of a subtle connection to the winners of the prize, because he also spent 2 years working as a tutor in India. And this year's prize for the best paper goes to a paper that was concerned about development in India. So, as I said, the prize goes to the best paper published by authors within 5 years of the PhD. And at EJ, we actually publish quite a high volume of papers, and we have a lot of good papers to choose from. But the paper that came out as a very strong paper looking at a relevant topic of importance to society, and extremely well done, is a paper that concerns the relationship between calorie intake and income. So the relationship between calorie intake and income in rich countries is usually positive. Rich people, they eat more. There's a higher intake of calories. And in India, there is a possible that the calorie intake actually has been declining as India has developed. The winning paper looked into this possible and discovered an important link between calorie intake and health, and essentially showed that because health has been improving in India at the same time as income has gone up, that has led to a negative relationship between income and calorie intake. And the paper goes on to demonstrate that in a variety of different ways, and quantifies this also. And I guess the result is important not only academically, but also in terms of active policies. So I want to thank the authors for submitting an absolutely great paper, and I want to congratulate them with this year's Austin Robinson Prize. So the prize goes to Josephine Du and Dean Spears for the paper Health and Hunger, Disease, Energy Needs, and the Indian Calorie Consumption Process.
Well, we have one more prize before the main session, although the prize, it turns out, resonates rather nicely with the topic of the main session. That's quite accidental and just a happy coincidence. So this is the Royal Economic Society Prize, and this is given to the best paper, irrespective of age, that appeared in the Economic Journal in 2017. We had a difficult task. We, by the way, a committee consisting of Martin Cripps, James Banks, and myself, and had a difficult task of reading lots of good papers. We all loved this paper. We liked lots of papers. others, and there were issues to be discussed, but in the end this one emerged as a clear winner. It's basically about Jewish history, but a sadder aspect of Jewish history, not achievements, but persecutions, and persecutions over the broader Middle Age period. It covers a very long period, 1100 to 1800, constructs a huge database, and shows very persuasively, I won't say conclusively, very persuasively, that the incidence of persecutions was increased by negative weather shocks. So to be precise, what is it, a one standard deviation reduction in temperature led over a five-year period to a 1 or 1.5% increase in the probability of persecution. That's over a very large data set of European cities. They control for lots of things. They find, interestingly, that this effect was less, was particularly important in states that were weak and in states that had, in areas that had relatively poor soil quality. And it's easy to see how that might have explained that. And of course, that points to more research on why we might look into issues about state capacity, studied elsewhere, of course, and also soil quality as a distinct feature of agricultural markets. Yes. Marginal communities. So overall, a really great paper which we all liked, and it's a pleasure then to announce the award. It goes to three authors, only one of them is here. We have spare copies of the certificate which will go to the two authors. So Robert Warren Anderson from Michigan, Noel Johnson and Mark Kuyama from George Mason University, and Mark is here to accept the prize on behalf of these authors. Okay.
All right, so there's one more announcement before I can introduce finally our speaker for the Economic Journal lecture. There will be drinks tonight, but for those who are still interested in more intellectual discoveries and knowledge, there's also a public event organized on campus at the Brighton and Sussex Medical School, organized by the Royal Economic Society, and on the topic of is it worth going to university? So it's taking place at 6 p.m. So for those of you who are happy to postpone their drinks for a little bit longer, just stay here. And there's a great set of panelists, Jack Britton, Kipoja Telja, Professor Adam Tickell, and Jill Winnes, who are going to talk about is it worth going to university? And so finally now, it's my pleasure to introduce Maristela Botticini for the Economic Journal lecture. Maristela is both a great scholar, but also a great human being. She's been a great contributor to the profession and so in many, many ways, but let me just cite a few ones. She's currently a director of EGR, that's a research center that's been central to the transformation of Bocconi into economic research hotbed, I would say. She's also served in several roles at the European Economic Association. For example, she's chaired the annual congress in
Gothenburg.
And she's been on several other committees. She's also served in several panels at the European Commission. And the list of her contributions to the professions is great, and that's, you know, we should be thankful to her. And of course, on top of that, she's a great scholar. She's one of the recognized experts in economic history, a booming field in economics that's contributing to our understanding of the role of culture and institutions to explain economic outcomes. And so that's in that role that she's here to give the Economic Journal a lecture on insights from Jewish history over many, many, many years, almost 2,000 years. The floor is yours.
Okay, I first want to thank Peter Neary for inviting me to give this lecture. The invitation came at a special time, he knows, so I'm more grateful than I can express here. And I'm very grateful to Estelle Caltillon, that for me is a role model when it comes to scholarship and also to contribution to the academic public good. So today I'm going to present what is a, has been a long, and it still is, a long and happy collaboration with my wonderful co-author Zvi Eckstein that many of you may know. Zvi now is at IDC Herzliya after being for a long time in Tel Aviv University. I don't know why many people said that economics is a sad discipline, because Zvi and I look quite happy, probably because we enjoy what we study. And so today what I'm going to do in 1 hour is survey 2,000 years of Jewish history. It can be done in 1 hour. In the first part, I will summarize what has been our past work, The Chosen Few, that has been published with Princeton University Press a while ago. And today you're going to see the very beginning of what is our second project, not yet a book, that we like to call it The Chosen Many. So I will give you a glimpse, basically, of what the new project will be about. So let's start with The Chosen Few. If I have to summarize in one slide what that book is about, it's basically serving 15th century of Jewish history and asking the following question. How come that at the beginning of the first millennium, there were about 5.5 million Jews, most of them, if not all of them, illiterate farmers, like the rest of the population. And then at the end of the period that we study, just before the expulsion from Spain, there are 1 million at most Jews living in the world. And all of them, basically, or most of them, have become educated merchants. By merchants, I don't mean literally merchants, but also artisans, craftsmen, doctors, all these occupations that we typically associate to non-farming. The new project and the new book instead start from the first one finished, because of course there were still 500 years of Jewish history to explain. And here we have the opposite trend. Now we start from the 1 million that we left in 1500. And in 1930, we have more than 16 million Jews. All of them literate, blah, blah, blah. I will show you more in a few, actually toward the end of the talk. Again, why? The two, the chosen few and the chosen many, despite showing completely opposite demographic trends, I want to push the idea that a common thread, basically, is linking Jewish history through these 2,000 years. And economics is actually great because it helps us disentangle from these huge arrays of historical events that happen a common, actually, story, hopefully a convincing one. So if you have to leave this room and say, okay, what did she say after 1 hour? This is basically, in a nutshell, what is our main line. If the question is, was it nature, genes, biological factors, blah, 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 or nurture, culture, parental investment in education and childcare, as I will explain a little bit in a few minutes, that drove most of the patterns in Jewish history, the answer is, for Zvi and me, it was nurture. That is, it was parental investment, first in education, The Chosen Few, and then in parental, in infant and child care, The Chosen Many, coupled with institutions. We'll see that institutions will play a big role in this story. So the two things in our story is not culture versus institutions. There is a huge debate in economics, we know about this, but it's actually culture and institutions that drive the story. Now, I'll try to be very fast, and I apologize in advance because I cannot cite all the great works that have been done related to what we do. But I want to mention that our book and books, when the second will see life, contribute to some strength in the economics literature. The first one is the so-called economics of culture and intergenerational transmission. You see there the most closely related works. There are many more. And I was in Paris last week. There was a conference organized by Alberto Bisin and Thierry Verdier. There were more than 100 economists working on this topic. So no hope to cite them here. Economics institution of institutions is a lost cause or mission impossible to try to cite all the relevant work. So I thought that it's nice to pay tribute to Douglas North, the father of this institution, of this field. Then our work is very closely related to an exciting set of literature, starting with Jim Ekman, and then very fascinating work by Cunha, Shenak and Ekman, and also by Orazio Attanasio in his wonderful presidential address at the European Economic Association back in 2015. So this is V trying to convince Jim and Orazio. They are laughing. I don't know how to interpret that, but hopefully they are convinced by what he's saying. We also contribute to a very, by now, large set of literature called Economics of Religion. Again, here you see some of the contributions. Marco Yama has played a big role in this literature and also has played a big role in this recent economic literature on antisemitism. So I'm so happy to see that the Economic Journal Committee has such great taste and awarded you the prize. And then they are not in this room, but our work would not have been possible without the contribution of generations of historians and demographers who provided the data. We also collected some of the data, of course, but a lot of the work has been done by historians and demographers. So it's correct to pay tribute to them if they're not in this room. So let's start from the chosen few, quick summary, and then we move to the new stuff. Now, I like always to start when I present the chosen few with this economic puzzle, which is not our puzzle. These are wonderful data collected by Simon Kuznets back in 1955, showing some striking numbers. At least I think we all agree that these are striking numbers. Meaning, in all the places where the Jews, the overwhelming majority of the Jews, I should say, were living in the early 20th century, we see that a disproportionate proportion of them are engaged in urban skilled jobs, whereas the rest of the population is not. And this was true both in places like the US, where the non-Jewish population was also heavily involved in urban skilled jobs, but also in places like Soviet Union, where most of the population is actually rural farmers and so on. So these numbers, if we are economists, simply raise our eyebrows, and we are trying to make a sense of what we see here. And in fact, the question of why are there so few Jewish farmers has attracted the interest of many people, and also wonderful economists like Becker and Stigler, who in their famous De Gustibus Non Est Disputandum article, in the introduction, this is one of the questions they raise. Now, what we did with Zvi was to embark on a very long journey of learning, first of all, what other people have written and have said, because we understood that what Kuznets was showing was not the outcome of something happening in the 20th century, but was the outcome of a very long trajectory of things happening in the centuries before. Now, out of, again, the millions of facts that I can show you, I always focus on these three, let's call them puzzles. The first is a demographic puzzle, meaning, again, I said at the beginning, we have roughly 5.5 million Jews in the first century of the first millennium. It goes down to 1,200,000 six centuries later. It raises a bit in the early Middle Ages, and then it goes down again quite significantly, remembering that they start at 1.5, by the end of the period that we study, right before the expulsion from the Iberian Peninsula. So there is this reduction in the number of Jews two times significant in the first part of the first millennium and after the Mongol invasions, which I will describe a little bit later. The population in the meantime, total population, this is total population, of course, of the places where the Jews were living, Europe, the Near East, and Northern Africa. The population in this period is growing, which means basically that when you calculate relative size and not only absolute numbers, the share of the Jewish population, which was about 9% of the population at the beginning of the first millennium, has gone down to 1% by the end of this period, meaning in the middle of the 15th century. The center, this is something important to realize because sometimes we have a bit a mixed picture of where the Jews and the center of Judaism was in the ancient times. Now, at the beginning of the period that we are studying, the center of Judaism is Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, where there are about 2 million Jews, a big community in Mesopotamia, today Iraq, 1 million, a big community in Egypt and Northern Africa, again 1 million, and then sizable communities in what is today Turkey, Syria, and a little bit Western Europe. That's the geographical distribution at the beginning of the period. Then the size of the Jews significantly goes down, almost all communities virtually disappear, and the only big and surviving one is the one in Mesopotamia. And it will stay like that for centuries, for 4 or 5 centuries, so the center of Judaism and Jewish life between the 6th and the 12th century is not certainly Europe, but is the Muslim Near East, namely Mesopotamia and Persia, Northern Africa, and of course Spain, when Spain got conquered by the Muslim Empire. Then we have migration happening and Western Europe becoming again a destination for Jews, and then at the end of the period that we are studying, there is a different picture, meaning now Europe, Western Europe is the center of Judaism and Jewish life, but there is still a large and sizable and important community in the Muslim Near East. Eastern Europe, which will play a major role in the second half of my talk, when I move to the new stuff we are doing, was almost nothing for all these 15 centuries. The second puzzle is an economic puzzle, meaning if we go back 2,000 years ago, the Jews are not already a literate, urban, mercantile elite. If this was the case, to some extent, our story, yeah, maybe would be still interesting, but not that much. What makes the story really sort of amazing and interesting is the fact that 2,000 years ago, the Jews are exactly identical to the rest of the population. They are a bunch of illiterate farmers. That's the picture. The picture changes dramatically after, sorry, I should learn to use the laser, changes dramatically at the end of our period, meaning that the 1 million Jews that you see between Western Europe and the Near East are mostly urban artisans, merchants, traders, bankers, doctors, and all of that. So, 2,000 years ago, all farmers illiterate, 15 centuries later, merchants, and that continues for the rest of their history, sometime the change, the transition must have occurred. And in the book, we document, thanks to the work of historians, of course, that the transition occurred between the 8th and the 10th century in the vast and urban Muslim empire stretching from Persia all the way to Spain. That's the time in which we have this occupational transition. And this is important to keep in mind. The timing here is all crucial. Once they become urban and traders, they start migrating all over. From the Muslim Near East, they come to Western Europe. I will come back later to this migration. But I want to point something here already important, is migration of, where did I write it here, Jewish skills. It's not that a bunch of illiterate Jewish farmer comes from the Middle East to Western Europe, and then kings or the Pope prohibit them, and the next day they become successful, wealthy traders and bankers. It didn't work like that. When they come to Western Europe, they are already from the Muslim Near East and Byzantine Empire, they are already an urban group of traders and bankers. So, why? Let's skip the economics of small minorities, despite prominent scholars like Weber propose it, but let's focus, I think, on the two first one. The first and the second one are the ones that everybody sort of knows. These prohibitions, restrictions, explanation, it is so deeply rooted that if you ask anybody, if you walk on the street, why Jews are a group specialized in occupations like trade, banking, and so on, the first answer is, oh, of course, they were prohibited to own land, they were prohibited to do this and prohibited to do that, and so on. It is so wrong for the first 15 centuries that we studied. No, I mean, we were shocked because we were also convinced that prohibitions and restrictions played a big role, But the point is, honestly, I challenge anybody to go and find restrictions in the period that we are studying, meaning there are no economic legal restrictions on Jewish economic activities in the Roman and Byzantine Empire, they're all farmers. But more important is there were no legal restrictions on Jewish economic activities in the Muslim period, which is exactly when they leave farming and they enter urban skilled occupations. In the land of the vast Muslim Empire, the Jews could own land, they could be farmers, and some of them actually kept remaining farmers. But then we find them spread in 450 different occupations, according to the beautiful data from the Geniza, from the Cairo Geniza. So, and restrictions don't even exist in the early times when they arrive to Europe. They come invited by princes and local rulers, invited basically to bring their capital and their skills. And at the beginning of the Middle Ages, they can own land in Europe. They can be farmers if they want. So this restriction story, please keep it in mind, is completely wrong, cannot explain the occupational transition. And it's also wrong, the other story, meaning there were persecutions, hence you prefer to invest in portable human capital instead of physical capital that can be expropriated. Of course, persecutions occurred, absolutely, but it's the causality that is completely wrong, meaning we see through the story that first the Jews invest in education, and I will tell you why in a second. Then there is the occupational transition, then they become prominent, wealthy, and they bring these skills to Europe, and then the persecutions happen. So it's exactly the opposite channel of explanation. Economics of small minorities, no time. So what in the chosen few Zvi and I proposed is, if restrictions cannot be the explanation, if persecution, hence portable human capital, is not the explanation, what else can explain those three puzzles? The demographic decline, the occupational transition into urban skilled occupation, and the diaspora migration pattern. Here, it's a desperate attempt to summarize history of Judaism, the relevant period, in one slide. So, again, let's travel back in time. And let's consider the two centuries before CE. So what we observe is Judaism is just a collection of sects, different religious sects, each pushing its own agenda. To be a good Jew, you should go to the temple and do sacrifices. No, to be a good Jew, you should learn to study the Torah, because in this way you can obey the law of God, so you should read and study the Torah. No, to be a good Jew, you should pray. So there were a bunch of groups, each pushing their own views on what the religion should be. And already before the destruction of the temple, that's important to remember, already before the destruction of the temple, we have that some rabbis issued this religious norm or ordinance or law, whatever you want to call it, that says a Jewish father either teaches his sons to read and study the Torah, the Bible, or should send the sons to the school, primary school, or the synagogue in order to do so. But for a while, that norm remained a sort of mute. What happened was in the year 70, at the end of a rebellion, that Judea rebelled against the Roman Empire, the Roman Emperor sent the legions, and we know the second temple in Jerusalem got destroyed and never rebuilt. The Sadducees, the group whose power and wealth was linked to the temple, disappeared. The Essenes, another group, have never played a major role. The only group that survives and becomes basically the religious and political leaders within the Jewish community are the Pharisees, the one pushing the idea that in order to be a good Jewish individual, you should obey the laws of God. How do you know them? You study them where in the Bible. So in the subsequent two centuries, we have two things going on. On one end, the religious leadership creates a set of laws, the Mishnah and then the Talmud, and institutions the rabbinical courts to enforce Jewish law among Jewish communities everywhere. And on the other hand, we have that the Jewish leaders themselves impose social penalties on members of the community who did not follow the rules of educating the children. So they called Ameya Haaretz the ones who did not invest in the children religious, I underline this, religious education. And so we have this picture in which we have a religion that for, I call, historical accident, groups disappearing and emerging, the only one that pushes toward a literate religion surviving, we have a religion that undergoes basically this dramatic change. Remember, that's very important, this norm regarding children education driven by Judaism does not occur in 1500 when the Jews are already a group of educated urban traders. It would have been a bit not much relevant. The norm and the enforcement of this norm through this social penalty and stigma occurs, as my co-author Zvi says, at a crazy time, meaning when basically the overwhelming majority of the Jews are a bunch of illiterate farmers for which investing in the children literacy education was just a cost with no economic returns. Okay, that's the important thing to remember. Model. No way, we have a little model, okay? The model basically has two key components. Everybody wants to consume, but for Jewish individuals, there is also, there is also utility coming from being literate and from having children literate according to a parameter that measures an individual religiosity. The community can punish you if you don't follow the social norm that says that you should educate your children. Basically, when you drive the machine, you get the two small findings, which are some Jews will invest in the children education, some Jews will not. And the second major decision that a Jewish individual has to do in our model is whether to remain Jewish or to convert. You may think, why conversions? We'll see in a second, conversion will play a big, major role in explaining part of the demography of Jewish history. And again, the model delivers the prediction that if you are educated as an adult father individual, you don't convert. Sorry. If you educate your kid, you do not convert. Those who do not convert, those who do not educate their children, some will convert, some will not. So the question is whether the model has anything to say with the historical fact that we observe. First piece of evidence. We know that back 2,000 years ago, we have a subsistence economy where you can see there half of the family budget goes into food, the other 30% is taken from taxes, and then little is left to buy clothes, not to mention books, the teacher salaries, or more than that. So we like to call it investing in children education in this rural farming economy is really a religious sacrifice that you do it because you enjoy having your kid standing in front of the community on Sabbath and reading the Torah in front of the community, but certainly you don't make this investment to have a better farmer helping you in the farm. So despite being costly, we observe that for this, see if I can go here, for these first 5-6 centuries, this is the Talmudic period when the Talmud is written, is compiled, a proportion of Jews decided to invest in the children education, namely to send their kids by the age of 5 or 6 to the primary school or the synagogue to learn and study the Torah. Remember that maybe for us it's so obvious and trivial today to think about primary education, but let's put ourselves in the feet of these people living 2,000 years ago, poor farmers, someone coming and saying if you don't educate your kids, you are a pariah in the community, basically. So this investment that a proportion of Jews decided to make is quite amazing given the timing and the economic context in which it was happening. The important thing here to remember is it's true that the religious ruling was about learning to read and to study the Torah, But once you study the Torah and you are able to read in Hebrew the Torah, you are able basically, you can in principle read any book, any contract, any letter, any whatever written in the same language. And we know by today linguistics that if you know one language, it's also easier to learn other languages as well. So what started as a purely religious requirement generated spillover effects over general literacy. And this will become relevant for what you'll see very soon. Now, we explain the chosen, meaning a certain proportion of Jews in the first half of the first millennium, they decide to obey this religious norm and to become literate and educated, and what's more important, to make their children literate and educated. That was the really revolutionary aspect. But then we have to explain why they become few over this time. So you remember, we go from 5.5 million down to 1.2, 1.5 at most. And the question is, why? Certainly, there were major wars, at least three revolts of the Jews against the Roman Empire. The first one in year 70 caused the death of 500,000 Jews. The second one in 115 caused the death of roughly 200,000 Jews in Alexandria in Egypt. And the third one, the famous Bar Kokhba revolt, determined the death of more than 500,000 Jews. So overall, we have that war-related deaths and also epidemics explains around half of the decline of the Jewish population at this time. But it's not enough, meaning when Zvika and I, and let me mention this is the right place, together with the help of fantastic research assistant, including my wonderful PhD student, Claudia Ray, when we were looking at this data, we told ourselves something is not right here, because putting together all the numbers of deaths from wars and epidemics and general population decline, we are still left with half of the decline, roughly 2 million, that no wars, no epidemics, nothing else can explain. And then by reading more, and also I have to say using economic insights and intuition, we realized that what was missing was conversions, voluntary, and it's important, voluntary conversions. So it's not the Roman emperor telling you must become Christian. It never happened actually, because the Roman emperors respected Judaism and never forced Jews to become Christians. So the conversions we are talking about were voluntary conversions of Jews out of Judaism into paganism, but mostly actually into Christianity. Why? Christianity, remember, is basically appearing at the beginning of our story again as one of the many sects of Judaism. And Christianity looked very similar to Judaism, except the ruling about educating the children was not there in Christianity. So to some extent, for a Jewish individual, converting to Christianity, probably they didn't even feel converting to a different religion, was more kind of changing a different group, sect within the same religion. But the change was quite an important one, because at the end, it determined a significant decline in the population side. I wanted to say something, but I don't have time to say it. Some indirect evidence that the Roman emperors were not forcing the Jews to convert is the fact that they actually enacted edicts to protect Jewish converts to Christianity. Okay, I have no time for this. So the first part is demographically, we explain the decline of the Jewish population, but then someone can raise the legitimate question. If you have now a smaller, but already educated, literate group, how come that it took such a long time before they actually all entered these urban skilled occupations? The point is, remember, you can invest in literacy and occupation, but in the ancient world, where the economy was mostly rural and farming, What do you do with this literacy in occupation? Nothing. You are able to read the Bible, which is great, but you are not a better farmer or anything like that. So the point is, if the world stayed rural and farming, first of all, the model delivers the prediction that Judaism would have disappeared through continuous conversion. And second, the model says that urbanization, actually, or migration, save, in quote, Judaism and the Jews. What do I mean is the following. We have the second historical accident occurring in the early 7th century, which is the establishment of Islam as a religion, and politically speaking, the founding of one of the largest empires in history, stretching from Persia all the way to Spain, under Muslim rule. This was a urban trading, commercial economy. And what happened at that time was there was a huge demand for skilled literate occupations, and guess what? The Jews were the first to enter these occupations exactly because they had a comparative advantage with respect to the rest of the population. So the transition from farming to trade and urban occupation happens exactly when finally the world, instead of being farming rural, becomes, thanks to the Muslim Empire, an urbanized commercial, highly commercial economy. Oh, no, I did something I didn't want to do, sorry. These are some numbers that show you urbanization occurring in the Middle East. You can see Europe is nothing compared actually to Iraq and Persia at that time. And we have exactly what I was saying, namely in roughly two centuries, a bit less than two centuries, from the 8th to the 10th, the Jews leave farming, enter into trade and urban occupations in general, and since then they remain, that's the mark of their history for the rest basically of the periods I will go into Sardin. The model is also for merchants. I'll just give you the two main insights. Once you become a merchant, both Jewish merchants and Christian merchants have an incentive to invest in education. Why? Because we know education and literacy has economic returns for trading and commercial activities. The Jews always have a bit more incentive to invest in education because there is also this religious channel. Okay? So the bottom line of the model is the Jews invest in education, but always more than non-Jews because of this religious thing. The second thing is about conversions. You work through the model and you find that once you are an educated merchant, you don't have an incentive basically to convert. So conversions should almost disappear once the Jews have become an urban population. Let's see historically speaking. So first of all, the Jewish population, which had kept collapsing since the first century, now between the 7th and the 13th, when they are living in the vast Muslim empire, it's actually stabilizing or even growing, which shows what? Certainly that conversions, and we know this also from narrative historical evidence, were not occurring. Maybe we hear of one conversion of a powerful Jewish individual because he wants to become the advisor of the Muslim caliph, but it's almost nothing compared to the thousands and thousands of conversions occurring here at the beginning of the period because you are a poor farmer and you want to leave Judaism and go to Christianity because you don't have to make that costly investment. Okay? So the bottom line is there are no conversions or few conversions in the period in which they become an urban group of skilled merchants, traders, and so on, which is exactly consistent with what the model predicts. Okay. Now, once they have left the countryside, moved to the newly founded cities in the Muslim Empire, and have become, one more time, a group of educated traders, they start moving. First, they move within the lands of the Muslim Empire. It's important to remember how they could move. They are free to move everywhere. They can go from Baghdad to Alexandria of Egypt. They can move to Sicily. Many of them did. They can arrive to Spain. Many of them did. From the Byzantine Empire, they also reach Italy through that channel and then spread all over Europe. So at the period in which migrations were occurring. I emphasize one more time, they are not leaving because they are kicked out or persecuted or no. They have skills, they have capital, they are creating a network basically of trading. And hence, what do? You go and move where there are other, even better economic opportunities. Western Europe in, oops, I need a graph. Western Europe, no, I'm going opposite direction, sorry. Okay, Western Europe here, you remember, is the rebirth of urbanization, trade picking up again, and the Jews are moving from the Near East to Western Europe, invited very often by kings, princes, local rulers, and so on, to bring capital and to bring knowledge, skills, and trading abilities. Okay? When they arrive, both within the lands of the Muslim Empire and to Western Europe, where of course we have now Christianity, okay, as the dominant religion, in both situations, in both contexts, despite the institutional context were very, very different, the Jews basically, they don't come as a group of illiterate farmers changing overnight their occupation. They arrive as a group of wealthy, educated merchants, and they keep doing that in Western Europe for the remaining part of the period that we are going to study. Here, some of the evidence. Where is it that the Jews could not own land? That's really amazing. I mean, I remember when we were working on this part of the project, Claudia remembers very well, we were wondering, where are the, please give us some restrictions. We cannot believe it. Something is wrong here, right? Because this restriction story, it is so deeply rooted that everybody expects to find Jews not able to own land in the Middle Ages. It's not true. It was not true, especially in the early period. When restrictions happen, and they will happen, it's because the Jews have become very wealthy, successful in their economic activities, they wish to buy land, and then they were prohibited simply because the local rulers, or more likely the local population, want to avoid them to buy land. So it's the opposite, really, nexus of causality to the standard typical story. You can see that again in Europe, in the early, I emphasize early period, they can trade, they can lend money, but they are not only lending money. And again, this is a distorted picture of Jewish history. It's not that Jewish people in the Middle Ages, they're only money lenders. We'll see, I will show you a little bit more precisely in the next few slides, okay? So they arrived to Europe, they settled in hundreds of locations all over Europe, including England. There are beautiful maps of Jewish settlements in England, if you are interested. And so at the height of the Jewish diaspora, we basically see a huge, this is coming from the census, called census, of Benjamin of Tudela, this Jewish traveler traveling everywhere and recording all the communities he was seeing. A huge community, large community in the Muslim Mesopotamia and Persia, a huge wealthy influential community in Spain, mostly under Muslim rule, and then a significant communities in Northern Africa, Turkey, the Mediterranean area, including Italy, where we had many, many Jewish communities. So, leaving farming, entering urban trade occupation. Then the occupational selection becomes even stronger, and we have that in the Middle Ages, it's true, especially in the second half, that Jews become even more selected into the top skilled occupation of old, which is banking and money lending. Now, the timing is important, and you'll see why the timing here and getting the timing right is very important. First of all, is that around 1000, the main occupation of the Jews in Spain, France, Germany, and southern Italy, you can see, you don't see much money lending actually. It's a commerce, long-term or local, crafts and medicine. It's a century later that money lending became the occupation per excellence of Jews living in England, actually, and it becomes very more important also for the Jews living in France, in Germany, whereas in Italy, in the Iberian Peninsula, the Jews still kept a variety of different occupations. By 1300, we can say that money lending has become basically the occupation, again, for excellence, of the Jews in France, Germany, and in northern and central Italy, whereas in Spain and in southern Italy, again, the occupational structure of the Jews was more heterogeneous. Why? Again, one more time, restrictions. So the most popular view, two actually popular view, is the Jews could not own land, hence they cannot be farmers, hence they become merchants and or bankers, money lenders. Or the guilds pushed out the Jews from their occupations and forced them basically to become money lenders and bankers. The second popular view goes on the other side and says, no, look, it's the Muslims and the Christians who cannot lend money at interest because of their religions. Who is left to lend money at interest? Jewish people. Why these explanations are so wrong? Again, is the timing. First of all, oops, sorry, I went too fast. First of all, I hope I convinced you it's not true that they cannot own land. In fact, they owned land and they had Christian farmers working these lands. And let's face it, for most of human history, most of farmers did not own land. If Jewish people wanted to be sharecroppers in France or in England or in Germany or in Italy in the Middle Ages, they could do it. But think about, you come from either the Byzantine Empire or the Muslim Near East, you are a wealthy, successful merchant, you want to go and plow the land in the middle of nowhere in Italy? Probably not, right? So the point is, once you start using economic thinking and insight, you see that these restriction stories completely really make no sense whatsoever, okay? So they can trade, they can also, yes, do money lending, but money lending is one of the many occupations they were doing when they first arrived in medieval Europe. Second, why the Muslims and Christians cannot lend at interest, hence the Jews had to lend at interest? Look at the timing. First of all, summing up what we have done so far, the Jews leave farming and enter urban occupation between the 8th and the 10th century. They have many different occupations. In fact, from the Cairo Geniza, we see, as I was mentioning before, they are holding 450 occupations. One of them being money lending, but not certainly the only one. So this story that Muslims cannot lend at interest, hence the Jews did money lending, is wrong, because money lending was one of the many, many, many occupations in which the Jews engaged in the Muslim Empire. How about Europe? Look at the timing. The Jews became prominent bankers and money lenders at least 100 or 150 years before the Catholic Church was prohibiting Christians from lending money at interest. So you think, they're already money lenders, then the Pope comes and says Christians cannot lend, that's fine, but it cannot be that the usury laws, explain the selection of Jews into banking and money lending. So what else? Going back to our explanation, think about, again, think as an economist. That's why economics is so great. It helps us think in different ways than other disciplines, okay? Today, to be successful in finance, what do you need to do? You need to have capital. You need to have literacy and numeracy. It helps having a network to share information and many other things. And it helps to have contract enforcement institutions. Jewish people had all these things already because capital, yes, you are a successful merchant in Baghdad or Constantinople, you come to Europe with your nice capital, you sell on credit, and then you become basically a banker. It's a small stretch from that, okay? So they had capital, literacy, I don't even repeat, by now we are convinced that they acquired literacy and education through their religion, I should say. Networking, absolutely. You remember the Jewish diaspora, communities everywhere spread, they share information. We have beautiful documents from the Cairo Geniza with these letters in which they exchange tons of information regarding prices, goods, and so on. And then contract enforcement institutions. Yes, the Mishnah, the Talmud, these laws going back to centuries, and the rabbinical courts that basically enforced these laws wherever the Jews were living, regardless of the local jurisdictional authority. So the selection into banking was not because of prohibitions, but because the Jews had the assets, the skills that nowadays are known to be great in order to do well in finance. The Mongols, and then we'll move to the new things. Do I have 15 minutes? I'm in big trouble. I wanted to show the new things. So should I skip the Mongols? But the Mongol is a fascinating story. I tell you why. It's really fascinating because the Mongol, it's not fascinating. I mean, they destroy completely the urban economy of the Muslim Empire. They bring back the world to farming, like at the beginning of the millennium. Guess what? Jews convert again, decline in the Jewish population living in the Muslim Near East. So there is consistency. They convert two times. There, at the beginning, here again, they don't convert in the middle during the Muslim Empire because the economy is urban. Oops, no. Open questions. Okay. So, chosen few was over, new stuff. And I promise I'll deliver very quickly the king size. So we take a picture in 1500, we have 1 million Jews. Half of them are Sephardim, living in the Near East, basically, in Spain, and half are Ashkenazim, living in France, Germany, roughly. That's the rough division. Before World War II, we have 16 million Jews, 2 million roughly are Sephardim, 14 million are Ashkenazim. How come? Meaning they start similar. There is this huge divergence between the two groups. And of course, the growth is happening in Eastern Europe. So, still, small percentage of the world and US population, but major intellectual and economic achievement. Fast? Okay. So, in the new project, and today you are going to see the first paper of this new project, and I want to mention that very important is joint work with Anat Vaturi, a wonderful postdoc at the Hebrew University. We are going basically to answer the following question. Now the center of Judaism in this second half of the second millennium will become Eastern Europe. So the Jews are only almost nothing, a negligible proportion of the local population in 1500. 3.5 something centuries later have become 15% of the local population. And not only that, look at this period, they had the highest annual average growth rate all over Europe. So these numbers are pretty remarkable. And the question is, what's going on? Where migrations from the west, from the east, are there still something related to fertility, mortality? In one line, were there migration from the west, meaning Western Europe? Yes. Initially, the population from Jewish population in Poland, Lithuania are basically coming from migration from Germany, Austria. Were there migration from the east, the famous Khazarian story? No. In the paper, we go a little bit more deep than this, no, but trust me. Okay. Higher fertility? No, actually. Lower mortality? Yes. Okay. So it's known that the exceptional Jewish population growth in Eastern Europe comes from lower mortality, but we provide more. First of all, we put together all the existing data and we provide some new data on the top of that, showing which mortality, that's crucial. Is infant and child mortality explaining about 70% of the lower Jewish mortality, which explains then the amazing population growth in these four centuries in Eastern Europe that I described. Why? And this is the link between the chosen few and the chosen many. In the chosen few, there was this religious norm enforcing children education that explain both the decline through conversions and the transition into urban occupation. But there is something else which we honestly ignored in the chosen few, also because we didn't have data absolutely to test. And it's infant and child care, meaning parents make investment in their children in many ways, not just education. And what is remarkable in these five centuries, for which we have great data thanks to the work of historians and demographers, is that Jewish infant and child care norms and practices dating back to Talmudic times, again, dating back to the times in which they are all farmers, basically, over the centuries created this, generated this lower infant and child mortality that in turn explains the exceptional population growth of the Jews in Eastern Europe from 1500 up to the early 20th century. But then you think, okay, wait a second, you are saying the Jews going back to Talmudic times, they already have norms and practices related to infant and child care that helped reducing significantly infant and child mortality. Why the Jews and not the rest of the population had these norms and rules? That's a great question, and that's where we make the link between chosen few and chosen many. Meaning, everybody, Jews and non-Jews, parents I mean, have an interest in having kids with a lot of physical strength, and surviving. That's common between Jews and non-Jews. But the difference is, because the Jews have this interest in investing in children education and cognitive skills, they have an additional incentive in investing in infant and child care, which eventually deliver lower infant and child care. Let me see if I can be more clear. These norms, again, appear back in Talmudic times, when the Jews are farmers, when there is also these norms about education. Now, the data, we collect a lot of data. Let me show you some of this data, finally. You can see, this is Germany, Austria. The Jewish population rate, it's always higher than the population growth rate in the total population in the period the 250 years, the beginning of the period that we are studying. But look at Poland, Lithuania. This difference is even more striking. So even when the total population is going down, also the Jewish population is going down, but half of that. So over these 2.5 centuries, the size of the Jewish population in relative terms is simply amazing how much is growing. Logs, key findings, I already told you. This is true also for the later period. Not so much for Germany, but for Austria, again, Jewish population growth annual always higher than the total population. But look again at Poland, Lithuania, where the big increase is happening, Jewish population rate always bigger than the rest of the population. So I go fast, I have 5 minutes, please. Okay, no time for the demographic transition here. So compare Poland, Lithuania, births, Jews, total, deaths, Jews, total, and then the difference, of course, natural increase. In terms of fertility, the Jews are basically very similar to the total population, actually, if you want to see a bit lower, but the huge big difference is mortality, you can see. And the same is true, by the way, if you look at Germany, Austria, same period, the fertility either is similar or actually the Jewish one is lower, but the striking difference is the mortality rates between Jews and non-Jews. The Jewish ones are always lower. So for the regions and periods for which demographers and historians provide data, and also we add our own data, look at these numbers. That's what I was saying. Where the lower Jewish death rate comes from? It comes from lower infant and child mortality. Oops. You can see here, at birth, 1 year old or 3 to 5 years old, doesn't matter which age bracket you take, there is always a significant difference between infant and child mortality among Jews and non-Jews. The same is if you put together Poland, Lithuania, and Germany, Austria. Bottom line is, the lower infant and child mortality explain about 70% of the lower Jewish mortality over this entire period. This is too much, okay? But I want just to show you a couple of slides. Druk. I can show you this for many things. Every time you see, today medicine says that something is good. Breastfeeding for 6 months and then change the food. Breastfeed as soon as possible when the child is born. keep the mother and the infant isolated from the rest of the environment. Do this, do that. So everything that modern contemporary medicine says is good for infant and children health, the Jews were already doing it centuries ago, unlike the Christians. And these norms and practices, again, date back Talmudic times, and they keep being repeated over and over time. Actually, they even get strengthened over time in the early modern and modern period. And the puzzle then is, yes, but why the Jews were doing it and not other groups or the rest of the population? And here is again the link between chosen few and chosen many, and I have almost concluded, meaning. When we go back to the initial question, nature versus nurture. Here we have a religion that at times in which you would not expect a religion to do something like that, meaning in a world of subsistence farming, where everybody is illiterate, including the Jews, here we have a religion that, first of all, has these norms regarding children education, but given the type of economy and society in the first 15 centuries, two things are going to happen out of that religious norm. Fewer Jews and educated and then becoming merchants, chosen few. Simultaneously in that period, you have a religion in the Talmud and so on that has a bunch of norms and rules regarding taking good care of infants and children. These norms get implemented through the centuries, and in the right environment, I didn't have time to talk institutions, institutions here will play a major role in this story, in the right environment, they generate actually population growth exactly of the size and dimension we have seen from 1500 until the early 20th century, where in Central and Eastern Europe, where now the center of Judaism and Jewish life have moved in the more recent times. So I guess that Salo Baron coined this term against the lachrymose view of Jewish history, which Zvi and I kind of like a lot, meaning all these stories of persecutions which existed, and we are not denying, I want to underline this very clearly, we often confuse the cause with the consequence. The persecutions were a consequence of the economic structure and specialization of the Jews in certain occupations were not the cause of many of the patterns that we see in Jewish history. So this is a beautiful graph with which I like to conclude. It's just two slides. This is an Ekman article in Science back in 2006 about the importance of investing in early child care. And so you know, I was trying to think hard the policy insight from 2,000 years of Jewish history, and I'm always very hesitant and humble in pushing policy insights when studying history. But I think here there is a nice link between a sort of an amazing story happening of a group in the population and through their religion. And so I had a sort of a dream the other night in which both Orazio and Jim ask, okay, you have been convincing. It would be nice, okay, to have them endorsing. And then asking, yeah, but when the second book is coming? And of course, that's the answer. And actually my reply is remembering that there is what I call the Botticini-Eckstein cycle, taking 12 years to finish a book. So we are in the middle of the cycle, but I promise we'll deliver The Chosen Many. Thank you so much. We go to drinks. No questions. Drinks.
For cutting this fascinating talk. Are there any pressing questions?
But I'm staying here. I'm happy to answer questions in a private way.
Thank you very much for this wonderful presentation. I have the following question. Are you aware of any discrimination against Jews, maybe informal discrimination, during the beginning of the establishment of Islamic Empire The reason I'm asking, because my own knowledge of history is a bit limited, and in Soviet Union, for example, in the USSR, there was no formal discrimination against Jews, but we know there has been a lot of anti-Semitism. If somebody had a Jewish background, he or she could not really enter a university or occupy high government job. When Islam got established as a dominant religion in the beginning of Islamic era...
I know the answer.
Yeah.
I know the answer. Okay. I think I understood what you want to ask. So, in the Islamic world, the so-called protected religious minorities, Jews and Christians and others, paid a poll tax in order to be allowed to continue to keep their religion. But the poll tax, it's nice, you compute the value of the poll tax compared to the average income of Jewish individuals back then, was actually almost nothing, okay? In return for this, they were the so-called dhimmis, the protected minorities. So you are a protected minority by the Muslim authorities. And of course, there were documented episodes of violence and discrimination and persecutions also during the Visigothic period and then later during the Muslim period. But again, these episodes are very rare, first of all, and they always happen, I'm trying to again one more time emphasize, as a consequence of the Jews becoming economically specialized in these occupations and quite successful, okay? But the discrimination you are talking about is very important because you are very right. Maybe you don't have discrimination in formal laws, but there are other ways for discriminating. And the best answer I can give you is, took the monumental work of Shlomo Goitein from the Cairo Genizah. He documents, through those documents, one more time, the Jews were having 450 different occupations. So to me, it sounds a bit a stretch to say that they were restricted and prohibited if they could do anything they wanted in the Muslim land.
Okay. Thank you very much.
No other questions. Thank you.